I can't believe this, you guys. I can't believe it. Look at her. This is a mama bear, and you can see her three cubs are with her. She's teaching them how to catch salmon to fatten up for hibernation. This black bear is brown in color. Black bear is the name of the species, but they come in all different shades, kind of like people in their hair. I'm Rae Wynn-Grant. I'm a National Geographic explorer, and I study black bears.
I am a large carnivore ecologist, which means I study meat-eating animals. In particular, I study black bears and their movement and behavior around human areas.
These are poop gloves from yesterday.
I like to tell people that I have a double life.
Rae to the stage. Rae!
I'm definitely a city girl. I didn't have my first experience in the outdoors until I was in my early 20s. That really helped me realize that this work was something that I could be excited about forever.
Go, 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 go!
A lot of people are not like me. They don't love bears because they have scary interactions with them. That's called human-bear conflict. Bears are actually really important for ecosystems to stay healthy. So part of my work is to get rid of human-bear conflict.
There was one point in North America where black bears were everywhere. And I mean absolutely everywhere. And then hunting came along. The timber industry cut down all the forest. We really lost a lot of bear habitat.
All of a sudden, herbivores like deer or elk started becoming way more abundant. When there's too many of them, then there's often too little grasses. Then the soils aren't healthy. There is kind of an ecosystem collapse. But all of that changed when we decided to properly protect bear habitat.
We set aside protected areas like Yellowstone or Yosemite and concentrated on bringing back America's wildlife. It's actually worked.
Black bears are getting back to the places where their ancestors used to live. That's happening right here in Nevada. Black bears are coming in from California, crossing the Sierra Nevada mountains, and recolonizing that historic habitat. One of the cool things that my GIS work allows me to do is map the areas where humans and bears are overlapping. All right, I need to figure out where these bears are. GIS stands for Geographic Information Systems.
GIS turns statistics and numbers into pictures and maps. So I can upload a data layer of bad bear habitat. Red means towns, cities, roads. This is Carson City, which is the capital of Nevada. So you can imagine that it would be dangerous for bears. And then I can have another layer of really green, lush forest spaces. Now I have my predictions of where is really good bear habitat and some kind of dangerous bear habitat. It's time for me to go into the field and track how often bears are going into the red zone to make sure people don't have conflicts with them.
Part of my field work requires getting up really, really early because bears are most active at dawn and dusk.
Look at this. Scratch. You can see right here. Scratch. That tells me bears are here. If I pull out my GPS unit and I use it to mark locations where I see bears or evidence of bears. This is data. GPS devices get a signal from a satellite telling me the exact location where I'm standing on this earth. I'll take a GPS point so I can mark the location and upload it into my database of points. This is a great water source for bears. Once I get thousands of points of where bears either are or have been, I can put that information back into the map. Pretty often, I also get to touch bears.
All done.
My favorite are the female bears that have cubs.
This bear in particular, but also the ecosystem and the health of the ecosystem.
I get to put collars on them, which is another way that I get really good GPS data. Inside of this black container is a GPS unit. So I'll set a trap for a bear. That makes it safe for me to tranquilize the bear. I put the collar around their neck, bolt it shut, and I'm out of there. This collar allows me to track this bear every couple of hours for 1 or 2 years. They might start part of their year up on a mountain where they den, all the way to a desert, and then end their year at the beach even. Other bears basically stayed in the same place the whole time they had their collar. This one went all the way. I've just uploaded the locations of every single bear that I've ever put a GPS collar on. They're showing up here as little colorful dots, different colors for different bears. What I'm seeing is actually making me a little bit nervous, because although the bears are mostly staying in places that don't have a lot of people, there are some bears that are getting pretty close to the cities. The only reason they would come into a human area is because they're looking for food. One of the cool things that my GIS work allows me to do is bring my information back to communities that live with bears.
Opening your door and having a bear be 5 feet from you.
Snooping around trash bins.
And you can tell how big that head is, too. They need to know where bears are, when bears are traveling, and how they can stay protected from bears. Science isn't useful unless it's communicated. And what I love about GIS is it allows me to collect data, to analyze data, and then to produce a visual representation. Yes, a bear-proof trash can. I love to see this. Governments have actually taken some of my work into consideration to change where they're going to build roads and highways to better protect bear habitat.
Do bears like marshmallows?
They do. Sometimes I'm
really hoping that my work with black bears can really help us to get to a place of coexistence for bears and people in the future.